Since we don't have much of a time, I haven't covered all the basics of blockchain as such, assuming that the audience will have some background about blockchain. So I'm just going to be talking about the different types of blockchain that exist, and then focusing a lot on how cloud can simplify your lives when it comes to blockchain, right? If you have any questions about anything, blockchain, cloud, or any other topic regarding emerging technologies, feel free to just put it in the chat, or I put my LinkedIn profile. Feel free to connect with me later, and we can have a chat if you're interested in doing a project, you're stuck somewhere, you need some help. Always happy to connect with fellow community women and help them out in this space, whatever I can do, right? So before without further ado, let's get started. What I'm going to be speaking about as a part of the agenda today, as I mentioned, the different types of blockchain that exist. What are the drawbacks when it comes to deploying blockchain onto an actual real-time system, right? We think about blockchain as this really emerging technology, which is bringing so many other legacy technologies together. For example, cryptography, distributed systems, decentralization, right? All of these concepts are plugged in into the whole entire blockchain ecosystem. And as we speak, there are a lot of solutions that are potentially coming to light in the space of blockchain. And I would suggest if you have been thinking whether you need to start learning blockchain or not, now is definitely a great time if, for all those early adopters who are able to come into the space of blockchain. A lot of opportunities are there in this space, right, going forward as well. So just to give you a brief idea of what is blockchain, right, before I go into the types of blockchain. Blockchain is a new type of distributed ledger, right? What that means is you have information that is and let's take an example of financial ecosystem, right? There are transactions that happen between various parties across the globe. Somebody's paying you some salary, or you have done some work as a freelancer and you're getting paid for that. Basically, a lot of financial transactions. You lent money to somebody and they need to pay you back. All of these are financial transactions, right? Currently, whatever has been happening in terms of the financial transactions, they are being facilitated by a third party or an intermediary, for example, like a bank, right? So if you need to go to a grocery store and purchase something, you either swipe your credit card, your debit card, or some kind of QR code you need to scan, and then it picks out money from your bank. But when the great financial crisis happened around the year 2008, right, 2007, 2008, a lot of big investment banking firms, one of the big, great examples would be the Lehman Brothers, right, went bankrupt. They declared bankruptcy. And in this case, when the financial institutions go down, what happens is the money of the common man is stuck with these financial institutions. And in order to remove these intermediaries, a technology or a system based on technology came about. And that is what we see now as blockchain. Initially, it came about in the form of cryptocurrency, that is Bitcoin. So the paper titled Bitcoin, peer-to-peer digital cash, electronic cash system, was released in 2009 by one person or a group of people called Satoshi Nakamoto. And the primary aim of this technology was to remove intermediaries in a financial ecosystem. And this technology consists of certain components, like these transactions, right? These transactions are clubbed together, the transactions that take place in the network. The network consists of peers who are a part of the blockchain, right? It is similar to you, suppose when you switch on the Wi-Fi router in your house and join the Wi-Fi network, you become a part of the internet, right? Similar to that, when you join a blockchain network, you become a part of the network. And those who are a part of the network are also known as peers or nodes, right? What happens is these peers or nodes can transact with each other, right? On that particular network, without the help of a third party or an intermediary, right? And the data of these transactions are available in the form of a ledger with everybody who's a part of the network, and everybody has the same copy of the ledger. So the ledger is distributed. This is the crux of the technology. There are two, three things that you need to remember here. One is that those who are a part of the network are called peers or nodes. Another is the ledger or the information that is captured on the network is in the form of a distributed ledger. That is, it is present with everyone who are a part of the network. And as and when more transactions happen, it gets updated. Now, blockchain started off with the financial ecosystem, but there are a lot of use cases in various other ecosystems, as we can see today. Okay? Now that we have a little bit, a very short, I know it was quite short and brief, a very brief introduction to blockchain. But now that you have some idea, right? Transactions are happening on a particular blockchain network, and then this information is captured in the form of a ledger, right? This is just a brief overview of what is blockchain. Let's take a look at what are the different types of blockchain, right? How can we design this network itself? Now, when we talk about the network, it's not just, you know, just like internet computers connected to each other, but there are a lot of other smaller things that are a part of the network and that determine how that network functions or how that network works, right? So what are the different types of blockchain? What are the different ways in which we can construct this network or we can make this framework? The first is called a public blockchain, and this was the first ever that came into picture, that is Bitcoin, and then post that Ethereum, etc. What that means is these are the networks that are available to everyone. Anybody and everybody can join this particular network, right? There are no restrictions on who can become members and who cannot become members. Basically, anybody who becomes a part of the network can perform transactions on the network, of course, if you follow the rules of the network. And it is open to public, right? So it is public blockchain. Now, when these kind of blockchains came into picture, enterprises or bigger organizations, financial organizations, and supply chain organizations, or bigger organizations that deal with a lot of sensitive data, try to understand how can they incorporate blockchain-based solutions, that is distributed ledger-based solutions, into their ecosystem so that they can take advantage of the cryptography principles as well as the ledger. Right? Now they have sensitive information. They can't allow anyone and everybody to come and see their different policies, what are the different transactions that are happening, who are their clients, and all this information, right? That's how private blockchain came about. What is a private blockchain? As the name suggests, private blockchain is a type of blockchain wherein there are only certain parties who make up that blockchain itself. Not everybody is allowed to join the network. Only few people who are working on a similar use case and are required to be in the network are a part of that network. So for example, think of this as a, you know, I would say an analogy, a good analogy will be a public Slack versus a company specific Slack. So if you're a part of an organization and your organization has a Slack, you don't want anyone and everyone to come and join your Slack channel, right? Because you're going to talk about your organization's specific information. You're going to talk about some sensitive information that need not be shared with everyone. Whereas you can have public community Slacks, which are like public blockchains, where anyone and everyone is allowed to join and ask questions on that particular technology, right? What happens in private blockchain is, the network access is restricted by membership rules. For example, in your company Slack, in your organization Slack, it's an invite-only Slack. You can join only if the admin invites you. It's the same in private blockchains, right? The network access is restricted by different membership rules based on the blockchain itself. Now, the industry for quite a bit of time has been trying to find a sweet spot between public blockchains and private blockchains. Can we design a type of blockchain where, though the entry is restricted, the development of solutions on that framework is available for everybody to either experiment or evaluate? For example, suppose there are four organizations who are working on a supply chain related problem. Now, a supply chain could be like it could be like transporting something from one place to another, right? That could be a supply chain. Now there are warehouses involved in this. There are transportation organizations involved in this. There might be financial organizations involved. There might be auditing organizations involved. So it's possible that these four particular specific organizations who are working on one specific supply chain problem, for example, you are transporting goods to to Walmart, right? Walmart is the supermarket that we're considering. You're transporting a particular type of fruit to Walmart. And now all the entities related to that supply chain are a part of this private blockchain, right? But similar kind of solutions might be built by, might be required by other entities as well. For example, Target, right? Or for example, any other supermarket chain, right? Now, all of these might want to look at a solution that has been built by Walmart. What are they doing in this blockchain, using the blockchain framework to ensure that the supply chain data is captured on blockchain, right? Now, this is the sweet spot that enterprises have been trying to find. How do we ensure that we build a solution for a particular use case, but we're able to replicate it across various various organizations that are working on the same use case? And that is where your consortium blockchains came into picture. Your consortium blockchains are neither completely public, neither are they completely private. They're semi-private blockchains, right? What happens is, instead of one organization just creating the blockchain and controlling it, multiple organizations are a part of the consortium and they have a stake in the outcome, right? So it could be that it's not just Walmart, but it's also Walmart, Target, and other similar supermarkets who are working on the supply chain problem. They all will become a part of the consortium, right? And they will together put their heads together and try to find out a solution to track supply chain logistics on blockchain. So what is a consortium blockchain, right? In a consortium blockchain, the consensus process is controlled by a pre-selected set of nodes. I know that this slide might be a little text heavy, but, you know, just I would say step away from, let's take one step back, right? And think about what happens in a blockchain, right? In order to approve a particular block to add to the blockchain, you need some kind of consensus mechanism. That is, what are the rules that everyone agrees to so that that block can be added onto the blockchain? Now, in a consortium blockchain, there are pre-selected set of nodes, right? I mentioned earlier that nodes are the ones who are a part of the network, right? There are pre-selected set of nodes who are allowed to be in the consensus process. They control the consensus process. And what happens is, because the entire group has varied interests, the consensus amongst them eventually is more trusted. So there is a more trusted consensus when there is a variety of people with different interests. So there is no central body here who's controlling, right? There is no single Walmart, there is no single Target or any single organization that is controlling the consensus process. Instead of each organization building their own solutions from scratch, they can share the development cost and time with organizations. Here is, of course, knowledge sharing, right? Everybody may follow different practices, but at the end of the day, the solution is going to be useful to everyone. So instead of building individual solutions, they can share the information with others who are a part of the consortium. These groups of organization, they will identify a specific problem that needs to be solved or that is common to many of them, and then try to build solutions for that based on blockchain. Okay, so this logistics, that was the supply chain example, which I already gave, right? So imagine that you have a supply chain logistics use case where you want to track information about a product going from point A to point B. It's not necessary that only one organization will use that solution, but multiple organizations will use that solution. And that is where your consortium blockchain comes into picture. There are various different types of consortium blockchains. We have Corda, we have Corum, right? The one that we will be talking about is Corum. I'll not go deep into the consortium blockchain itself, but Corum is a consortium blockchain that is based on Ethereum, right? And that is what is supported by Microsoft Azure. Before we go to that, let me talk a little bit more through how cloud can now come into picture, right? When we think about blockchain deployment, right, when we talk about consortiums, we th- think we I've already told you there are multiple organizations that come into picture, right? And then we need to pre-select set of nodes who can work with the consensus amongst each other, right? Thinking about this itself is seems like such a cumbersome process, because you need to ensure that you have a network that is deployed, which has multiple organizations come into picture. You need to ensure that each of them has some kind of, you have some kind of membership service that you're building to invite them onto the blockchain, and then to verify that they are the right kind of entities. And then you apply your consensus protocol. That is when your consortium itself is set up. After that, you need to build, you know, your smart contracts, etc. So what are the actual challenges when it comes to blockchain deployment? One is scalability, right? So when we think about scalability, we want our solutions to be able to work at a large scale enterprise level, not just for a small POC that we are building, right? For a hackathon or something. So scalability has been one of the primary issues in blockchain because of the consensus, especially because in public blockchains, the consensus protocol can become slower and slower as more and more nodes join the network. So scalability is definitely a big challenge. How do you create solutions that can be used by large enterprises? Increased cost when it comes to the deployment process. Like I said, you will have to ensure that your network has so much security. It has so many membership related rules in such a way that you can accommodate all these different organizations that are going to be a part of your consortium blockchain. And most importantly, you need a lot of knowledge, or you need that administrative ability to manage these different peers. What if one peer goes down? What if one of the organization, what if their network goes down, right? What will the admin do in that case? What if an organization that was meant to be a part of the consensus protocol is not being able to validate the blocks? What will you do in that case, right? These could be some challenges where the administrative abilities of a person managing the blockchain needs to be very, very strong. Right. And that is definitely a big challenge in this space right now, to find SMEs. Right. Now, how can and OK, so the in the previous slide, I spoke about the overall blockchain deployment. Right. Now, when we think about an application, right, a specific application, what are the things that you would need to do to build a particular blockchain application? Right. We also call them decentralized apps. But decentralized apps are just your, you know, core of your application. But suppose you need to build an end-to-end application. You have a client, which is, you know, calling your blockchain, and then in your blockchain you are running some kind of decentralized app, which is having some business logic, and then it sends back some data to the client, right? So this could be your simple blockchain application, for example, a decentralized voting system, right? So from when somebody registers on a system, they want to vote. So they want to first become a member, and then they you need to verify at the back end their credentials. Are they allowed to vote for this particular county, this particular, I don't know, state, etc., right? So this, all of these backend processing is going to be done by your application, and then some information will be stored. Your voting logic might be your blockchain your DApp, right? Your decentralized application. But this is your entire application that you need to build. So what do you need to do in that case? You need to launch and manage the network, the blockchain network itself, the consortium network, where your whole application logic will lie. You need to work with smart contracts. Smart contracts are pieces of business logic which will tell you, given an input or given some kind of parameters, what should be the logic that should be running at the backend, right? You need to not just build the applications, you also need to extend the applications with different plugins, right? Now, you in a voting application, for example, you may want to add some analytics modules, right? How many people are voting from this particular zone? How many people are voting from this particular region? On which day is the voting count higher? And on which day is it lower? You may want to extend the application by adding some analytics modules. Or you may want to analyze the performance. Okay, how fast is the voting taking place using this application, right? You need to do all of this when it comes to not just any generic application, but also to a blockchain application. So what are so having seen both sides of blockchain deployment as well as building an application, what are the advantages of using cloud, right, when it comes to building a blockchain application and deploying it as an end-to-end solution, right? You have low cost access to technology because most of the cloud providers, whatever service they provide, so most of the cloud providers like Azure, Oracle, they provide blockchain as a service known as BaaS, right? So the blockchain as a service is a pay as you go service, right? So only if you are adding extra nodes, you will have to pay for those nodes. You don't have to just bring up a network and let it be, right? You don't have to keep paying for the network even if you're not adding the nodes or even if there is no workload on that. So your cost becomes relatively lesser when you're using cloud because you get low cost access to this beautiful technology, right? Of course, it offers massive scalability. Why? Because cloud will allow you to build your applications in such a way that you can tweak the number of users depending on the cloud platform they are using or depending on the application itself that you're using, right? So if you want to increase from 100 users to 1,000 users overnight, you just need to tweak some configuration in your system and you will be able to do that easily. That's why cloud systems offer massive scalability when it comes to blockchain application. Because of the underlying infrastructure or the underlying way a particular cloud operator has built their system, they already have some security principles that are associated with data security, right? So you don't have to worry about data leakage or exposing your data to the public domain without any without any security barriers. You don't have to worry about that because cloud providers will already provide you with increased data security, right? One of the interesting things that I really like and appreciate as an advantage of using cloud is access anywhere. When you think about blockchain systems, right, it is very difficult to set up to run your own node, right? Any other blockchain, public blockchain framework that you think about, you can run, you are allowed to run your own node, but it is a big cumbersome process to run your own node because it requires you to have that kind of hardware along with you, and a lot of information is required to be able to set up and access the node, right? Whereas cloud, it's just a one-click login, right? If you think about Microsoft Azure, it's just a one-click login and you are able to access your nodes from anywhere, right? Whether you're working from US or whether you're working from India or whether you're working from Europe, it doesn't matter. You just need to log in using your cloud credentials and you're able to access your node, right? Imagine running your node on a physical hardware and then needing to carry it wherever you travel, right? It's such a cumbersome process. Of course, better software because cloud, many of the cloud providers are already very established and have been in this game for a really long time. So you know that when they are giving some kind of solution, some kind of service, they have expectations, client expectations to meet. So the software that you're going to be getting is going to be definitely of good quality. So finally, we are here, which is what it is all about in today's talk, the Azure Blockchain Service, right? What is the Azure Blockchain Service? The Azure Blockchain Service simplifies the way you are able to create a consortium blockchain. That's what it is all about, right? So if you see this complicated definition that you will find on the slide, it says that you're able to manage, you're able to create, manage, and work with your consortium blockchains very easily using this Azure Blockchain Service. The Azure Blockchain Service, it is in preview mode. That means it is still they are still tweaking and they are improvising on that, right? But it is already a great way to get started with blockchain as a service. Right? You can manage the governance of your consortium. You can everything is managed by using one click using this platform. And all you have to do is focus on actually building the business logic for your application, right? You don't have to worry about the management part, the deployment part, etc. So here are some advantages of being able to use the Azure Blockchain Service, right? There is a built-in consortium management. So that means you can create your own consortium very easily. You can add the members, and then you can kind of work with all sorts of things. Right? Easy blockchain data publishing. So what that means is you're able to track the metrics of the transactions that are happening in your particular blockchain, right, within the different nodes very easily, because the metrics are published already in the form of charts. Or you are able to, you know, tweak the different metrics that you want to explore. And you can do that very easily using the Azure Blockchain Service. It is over design. What that means.